Hi everyone, I'm Liz Brown Swanson and welcome to RPV City Talk. I'm here with the great mayor of Rancho Palos Verdes, Mayor Susan Brooks, back again to just keep us up to speed on everything going on in our community. And I always ask, how's life in paradise?
This is our paradise. We share it together with the whole peninsula. It's good.
Yeah,
it's good. A lot is going on.
A lot's going on. You have a lot going on. You've been traveling all over the map on behalf of the city. You just got back from Washington, D.C. Tell
Correct.
Us about that trip. You had some city business there.
Yes. Originally, I was invited to a conference at the White House for women mayors. And I somehow missed that information. So they called to apologize to involve me in another one, which had to do with mostly county supervisors and local leaders of the states of California, Hawaii, and Alaska. Mm-hmm. And it was mostly California county supervisors. The only other one from Los Angeles was Catherine Barger, county supervisor. So we actually had a conference. It was really like an A-list of people, we were told. We actually had some of the main secretaries of the interior, Ryan Zinke. He's a former SEAL Team 6 leader.
Wow.
And he is now the head of Secretary of Interior. And so that was very important for me to be able to meet with his senior staff and him and those people there so that we could address some crucial issues with our city and our city land here, which part of it the National Park Service tries to manage without managing.
Right. So you were meeting with the chief deputy from the Department of Interior to discuss sort of what's going on with deed restrictions here
that might impact
our ability to put to build here at the where we're
located. Right,
and
it's not just that. We really need emergency services here because at any given time now we are the most populated area of the hill right here at where City Hall is. So, because we have Terranea, we have the preserve, we really need the fire services. And we really need the fire services. And that is actually our number one most dangerous disaster-prone issue,
right,
as we learned from a later issue.
So there's the restrictions are here because this was federal land given to us and you have to follow certain guidelines. And hopefully
yes.
get some of those
yes.
lifted. So were you Correct. Happy with what you were able to accomplish? I know you got to tour the White House.
Thank you. I did get a tour. And also we met with Secretary Chow, the transportation secretary, veterans, Homeland Security, and the president popped in, and he had about 20 minutes. That was a kind of a surprise visit, but not really. And then Kellyanne Conway, his special assistant, who I knew from a previous life when I was running for Congress. She was actually my pollster back in those days.
Wow.
She came and spoke on opioid addiction, and I have a real keen interest in that because I happen to know somebody very close who has that issue. And it was overall really intense, and it was really filled with a lot of information. And thanks to Catherine Barger and Janice Hahn, our supervisor, we were able to utilize the services of their staff that they have in D.C. to get these appointments with the higher ups of the Interior Department. So I feel that was just really hopefully, prayerfully, we were in the right place at the right time.
All right. I know we have a lobbyist there as well working on this very issue.
Right, but
for the
she's
city.
Actually identified as a staffer. So they don't like the word lobbyist in D.C., and no, with this administration, they just don't like the word lobbyist. They don't like this whole staff to staff. They really want to see elected officials. This is the message that was given to us. So that was good.
You mentioned County Supervisor Janice Hahn, how helpful she is. And I also was with you at her second annual State of the County address that she gave here at the Port of L.A., packed audience. It was hosted by the San Pedro Peninsula Chamber.
Right. It was great.
And she had a very important message to share for the business community and just sort of all that she's able to accomplish. And of course, she happens to be one of your really close friends as
right.
well.
Right.
So you were there. How do you feel like what was important that she really brought up that would be important for the residents to know here? Like as far as how she helps the peninsula, the things she does.
Thank you for the question. She does a lot for the whole county. So she really went over and photographs of our city and, of course, our anniversary were there. She helped with that. But I think really crucial things is she's helped with the public safety issues, with the sheriff's department, and we have this coyote issue. And so she and I were discussing it at one point, and She's walking one morning and she's seeing them, and it's just seeing them is not enough to take action. But if you see a bold, aggressive coyote, then when I let her know that there were not enough staff members to handle this through the county agricultural weights and measures area department, they did put forth more funding this year, so there are additional personnel now to help us with that issue. And we are working together on that issue with the whole Palos Verdes Peninsula.
Hey, this has been really important to you as you've served as mayor here. As you said, you want to see, you know, the communities together come together.
I really
do. You've been really good about that. In fact, you had an event that you had with all the different elected leaders from the peninsula. You just hosted. Talk about that.
We had an event yesterday at a private home whereby all the elected leaders were invited, the city officials, so that we could gather together in a manner where which we are all now sharing a lot of this public safety information. We're sharing information on coyotes. We're sharing information on some of the terrible things that have happened in the schools nationwide. And so we've got a lot of involvement in this peninsula-wide emergency preparedness program. And it's really important that because we have four cities, that we really do the best we can to utilize each other's services when we really need it, and to know who's on page what, and that we're all on the same page.
Right. So you said you had
In fact, we are with PV Estates Police. They just apprehended five of these individuals who've been robbing homes, and one of those homes was in Rancho Palos Verdes.
Right. So it's good that we are connecting like that. And also, you mentioned emergency preparedness. I was able to attend what's called Prepared Peninsula Expo. It was at the Norris Pavilion, and our city, of course, had our emergency preparedness committee there repping the city, and it was really, really effective. A lot of members of the community coming to learn what to do and for disaster planning, you know, to be ready. And it was sponsored by all four cities on the Hill, just like Dr. Jones, who just came.
Right.
Dr. Lucy Jones, famous
worldwide. Yeah, that was awesome.
So Dr. was segueing to her because about emergency preparedness. Dr. Jones was, she's known as Earthquake Lady. This is her book. She came and spoke to the community. You introduced her.
I did. I think people were glued to their seats. The house was packed.
Right.
We had 300 people in that Ridgecrest Auditorium. And our city did sponsor the main chair of this particular presentation. And we have to give a shout out to Tracy Bonanno from our staff. And our whole emergency preparedness team, headed by Diana Feinberg, from one of our residents. I mean, they have been fantastic. This book deals with what has gone on in the last 2,000 years with regard to how people addressed earthquakes, from a religious matter to, I mean, she talks about Pompeii in the first century AD, and she had these amazing slides that she was showing. So it was an evolutionary presentation, but she also talked about right here in Palos Verdes, what we can expect. And she took a lot of questions from the audience, which was wonderful. I think some of the most interesting aspects came from the Q&A.
I bet.
And one of the residents asked a question about which homes are more stable for an earthquake. And she did say that actually it is a home on a slab versus a crawl space, because that slab, the home is right on it. But if you're on a crawl space, she said, it was really worth your while to retrofit it, and then you would save hundreds of thousands of dollars on your house if you do. A lot of the homes are not retrofitted because there is a belief that because we are largely on bedrock here, that we're not as affected. But there are two faults underneath us. One is the Palos Verdes fault, and the other is the Inglewood fault, which is deeper and longer. But both of these, one's a 700-year fault. Apparently, we're overdue for at least the San Andreas.
Right. They should buy 150
years. 150
years. What I found about her in this book, the big ones that she thinks, you know, everyone could read about, she's like, the big one's inevitable. It's going to happen. Like, don't worry about predicting it. Just be ready for it, because that's the catastrophe. And I think that's what her focus is now. She no longer works for, she was working for Caltech as a seismologist.
Right. She was a federal government employee. Now she's so happy not to be working for the
government. Yeah, and anytime there was an earthquake in California, you turn on the news and she would be the one explaining it. And she really calmed you down about what to think. But She just said, you know, be ready, get your, you know, your kit together, have food, have water. Just the basics. Many people don't do that.
No.
Are you ready?
You know, she just keeps telling you, well, yes, I always have water. You know, I mean, people.
And wine. No.
Yeah, I do. I do have a wine cellar of wine. But she does point out how important water is to have like a 3-day supply of water at least. Because if the pumping station, which pumps up our electricity, which pumps our water, if that should go down, we won't have any services and we won't have that water. So it is really important that we know. We are in a hill. It's called the hill for a reason. Mm-hmm. And it's not easy. It's not as easy as it is in the flatlands to get things transported, as you can see from the landslide, mm-hmm. with the sewer pipes outside every
day. So, but that was fascinating. And
this catastrophe that she talked about in Iceland in 1783, the greatest catastrophe, that it was the Laki eruption in Iceland in 1783 and 84, and it was a volcano, and millions of people died. And it traveled all over the globe. So the effects of that volcano with the ash and everything else, it's amazing how we don't realize that if you're not. And we remember when Mount St. Helen went up, and that was quite a travesty. But this really does go into some interesting aspects.
And she did say, though, the biggest myth when I asked her about earthquakes is that people are afraid of dying in one, and you're not. You have more chance of getting killed on the East Coast in a snowstorm in the winter. That's not the worry. But, you know, we just all need to be doing it. And if something happened right now, we started shaking, we drop. Cover and hold on. We don't have a very big table, but we'd squeeze under.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Drop
well,
cover and
this
hold
table
on.
Here. We take our little 45th anniversary.
Oh yes.
Glass, water glass, by the way.
And we'd say cheers.
Cheers
for shaking
with
things
our water
up.
Glass.
No, I'm kidding.
And but it, actually, the biggest threat that we really face on the peninsula, and she knew it, and she pointed it out, it's fire. It's the same reason that we need this help, this federal help, in order to get emergency services. So. Wildfires is, you know, we've had at least 6 of these in since the city was incorporated, and some of them have been very major. So mm-hmm. we do have this constant issue that we have to remind people. I saw somebody the other day get out of their car right over by the preserve, and he was standing on the over cliff for on Hawthorne Boulevard, where right below is all the brush. And he was lighting up a cigarette. And I thought, that should really be kind of against the law.
Right.
Because where'd he throw the match? And, you know, a lot of the fires, I know when I'm up in Seattle and it's dry in the summer, people throw the cigarette out the window and it starts brush fires. Well, down here at PV Drive South and PV Drive East, fires have started there more often than not as a result of the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a fine. It's a $500 fine.
Right. Well, I
think, we just went right off.
I know.
We went right off target.
Yeah, no, it's okay. But I want to move on and talk about, we always start our show off usually talking about public safety, and this is all about keeping our public safe. RPV was one of the safest cities in California, 8th safest city. Doug Wilmer, the city manager at your October 16th meeting, made that announcement. So no surprise, though,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, SafeWise, which actually tabulates this information, came out and they did say that we are the 8th safest city in the state of California. And I remember when Doug came here, we were looking at our goals 3 years ago. We were identifying what they would be. And one of them is we wanted to be the safest city in California. So we're right up there because everybody else is trailing way behind.
Okay.
And those ALPRs all around the peninsula, another joint effort that we all did together.
Exactly. Is there more, though? What else could we be doing in your mind? I mean, in terms of, we are putting more money and resources here in RPV. So is there anything else?
Right, we are. We have the RIG program, and we also have the loan camera program. We have, if somebody's going out of town for the weekend or a week or 2 weeks, you can get a free loaner camera from the city. And we have this program for you so you can keep an eye on your home from your phone. And you'll have that opportunity. We do a lot, but you know, people need to do for themselves as well, and they need to see something, say something.
Yeah.
That is really crucial in these times when we see so many things happening.
Unfortunately, one thing we are seeing, and I've seen them on my walk, are coyotes, and the city filed away the coyote management plan at your meeting in October. You mentioned about the Supervisor Hahn adding more resources here, and the bottom line is we are starting to trap.
We are starting to trap, and this has been a big issue. A lot of people, including myself, but this has been one of my pet peeves is to deal with this
issue.
No pun
intended.
No, but they're not pets.
No.
So we have to remember that. And so when you have a bold, aggressive coyote, one that is demonstrating, it's just right in your face, and it's not just something you see in the distance. But the city, and together with the Department of Weights and Measures from the county, we did get additional monies and for the whole South Bay region. So we are working this together with the other Palos Verde cities as well.
All right. And I know the thing is you can contact the city whenever you see one. You
want to
call
enforcement officers.
Because there are reporting and just sort of to get a feel because right. I wondered, like, you know, where on the Hill are we seeing more than others? I know they're close to Western Ave up in that area. I
mean, well, no, they're all over. And actually, there is a new. There's a new web. It's actually online on the RPV website,
right.
And so you'll see it's a specific location that you go to for the whole Palos Verdes Peninsula, where all four cities now are together in identifying the locations, anything aggressive, anybody's animal has been taken. Then we can we can really hone in where our attention needs to be.
And I know they were trying to work on a wildlife watch program where neighborhoods would do
and
just like a neighborhood watch, and we're trying to get more residents to get involved with
and
that because that's a neat concept.
Right, and so these code enforcement officers we have are great, and they have actually been trained in wildlife watch. They go out and work with neighborhoods where there are sightings. You know, a lot of this people have to know that there are fines for feeding the coyotes.
Right.
And it's just like the public safety. You know, what do you do with that if people leave their doors unlocked? It's like common sense has to weigh in here at some point.
Okay. We're going to move on to an issue that's created a lot of noise or taking noise away, and that has to do with the gas-powered weed and debris blowers. They're banned officially for using here in single residences starting January 1. Let me go back to this.
So this was like one of my real pet peeves also. Yeah. So I did bring this forth to the council and they agreed.
I want you to weed this one out.
We're going to weed this one out. I talked to my neighbors. They must have the loudest ones in the entire, the commercial.
Gas powered.
Anyway, any gas powered leaf blowers, not all leaf blowers and not all locations. So gas powered leaf blowers, which are noxious, which are also the noisiest, in addition to being polluting, are the worst, especially when the electric blowers have come down at or below the price of the gas-powered ones, and their chargers are easier, they're more easily recharged now. So this is a great opportunity, but it's for residents only, not for commercial or the golf courses. But we also know that there is a green area. Rancho Palos Verdes, the whole Palos Verdes Peninsula, is a hill, and it's green for a reason. So we could never possibly do what they did in Redondo Beach, which was outlaw all leaf blowers. I mean, I know there's quite a stir about that.
Mm-hmm.
But we're just saying, as of January 1, no gas-powered leaf blowers. And
How are we enforcing that?
Well, they're going to be enforcing it. But first thing we're doing is letting everybody know. But there will be violations.
Mm-hmm.
There will be code. If people are warned, and first you get a warning, and like we do with everything.
So you
get a violation, and you will get cited. So I think what's important is that we tell your gardeners that to get, you know, a lot of them all know about it. I mean, the people I just talked to today, they said, yes, we know as of January 1st. And they said, we can't even use our leaf blowers in Redondo. I said, you know, that was one thing when we didn't have a drought and you could hose down your driveway. But you can't hose down your driveway and you got to have something. You can't expect to sweep when you're if you have anything more than a pathway.
So why now did the council decide to do this? What was the need now? It's just that you've had a lot of complaints from the community?
Yes, we did have a lot of complaints. And we got a lot of letters, a lot of calls. I always received I receive a lot of phone calls from my constituents.
I can't imagine how many calls and emails you get on a daily basis.
And you know, and really makes you stop and think. And then you see it's going on with other cities. They're taking, I think, more strident action, and that's not appropriate in this sense. But I think, you know, there was today I read an article about noise and how noise is identified as the new equivalent of secondhand smoke. Noise is going to become one of the central nervous system's challenges as time goes on, and we have so much noise in our heads.
Like noise in the channel.
From this and everything that comes from our phones.
Motorcycles driving down PV Drive East. Now they've calmed down.
That kind of noise.
Airplanes flying overhead.
We're addressing that issue. Yeah, the city is going to be addressing that issue, and we really are thankful for our residents for
helping us. But it's important.
You
know, it's a health issue.
It does become a mental health and a physical health issue. So this actually should be, I think it'll be really helpful.
Okay. I'm never going to keep you quiet.
Yeah, no matter where I am.
We love to on this show, go over just sort of some of the agenda items that came before you. We're looking at back on the month of October. One of the issues that came up had to do with traffic safety improvement project. So for anybody that was watching that meeting, it's between Headlands and Bronco.
Right.
And it was a $500,000 project that's been around for about 8 years, you said, but the table, you guys decided just to scrap it? Or
so what happened was that has been around since 2010, and it was federal money that was sitting on the table.
$500,000.
And it was $500,000. And at some point, in fact, I think in a lot of points, you know, this council is very careful about taking grants because there are always strings attached. So in this particular one, it had to do with equestrian trails on the most dangerous curve of all of Belfort's Drive East. So it got to a point where it was kind of an oxymoron, like, why are we doing this?
Right.
Actually, on the other side of the street, which is not in this funding, there was more space to put a regular trail rather than an equestrian trail. And so we're trying to see if we can work something that will be safer for pedestrians. Mm-hmm. Because right now, there are people who do cross that street. It is very, you know, it's called Dead Man's Curve for a reason.
Right.
So you really want to, they are little by little working on parts of Palos Verdes Drive East. You'll notice those fences going up and to keep people safer.
This was part of a project that looked at the whole big picture, right? From one end of PV Drive.
Yes, to all the way to the other. Yeah.
Well, so
we actually will come back and we ask staff to go and revisit it and look at it and see if it's something that we could do for 2019 to put into our budget, our own budget.
One of the great things you get to do as mayor is you were doing the Citizen of the Month awards.
Yeah. Well, it's called, I didn't get to do it every month because we had such packed, we had 31 meetings so far.
Yep.
Yeah.
And you've got that one left in November coming up.
One left.
As mayor. Third time around as mayor.
I'll tell you, it's something.
But you named Len Wood. The Citizen of the Month. He was our very first city manager in Rancho Palos Verdes. He was an interesting person who's done so much for the community. So easy to pick him, but, you know, why for you?
Well, Len has been an instrumental person for me personally, as well as to the city. He was the first city manager. He also established the principles for budgeting and finances with the city. He helped to write the general plan and the coastal plan. So he got these things going all within the first decade. And in fact, he's working on something right now with Carolyn Petru. We love Carolyn Petru. She was also a citizen.
Yes.
We're just saying awards because we couldn't do one every month. But former deputy city manager, they're working on a scrapbook together that will take you through not just the incorporation. There's a lot been written. Ken Dida wrote something on that. But something that takes you through how everything happened in that preliminary time that has really made sure that we stay the semi-rural community we are. Because we look different than anywhere else. Palos Verdes Peninsula and Rancho Palos Verdes in particular.
I know. And this is exciting because you were mayor this time at the city's 45th anniversary. The party continues, right, for the year?
Right. Well, the celebration goes on. And, you know, we really do have a lot to be grateful for because we did manage to maintain that same ambiance. And we are still one of the lowest tax cities in the entire South Bay, if not the lowest.
we're going to have you on again and for the year's up just to do our year in review and look at all the things that you've been able to accomplish. But as you know, this is your last month serving as mayor. Is there some things you're excited about? I mean, I know you said, are you ready for a break? I'm sure.
I am. I'm ready to say, so I'm ready meetings. To pass the baton. Because actually, you know, in these elected offices, I know, term limits are important, and if people come back and they choose to come back, that's one thing. But, and I did not expect to come back, having been here in the early 90s. But I have to say, this is essentially a volunteer job. It's a lot of work. And it, for me, it's been full time this year. And while I love it, I also know that I want to spread the wealth with the rest of the council mm-hmm. members. And everybody takes the position and addresses it differently. Mm-hmm. But we all actually have the same voting rights. We all have the same one vote. Right. So that's different than it is in a city like Redondo, where the mayor doesn't even get to vote.
And so, your council has a lot of 5-0 votes, so you're on the same page.
We have we are, but we have some that where there is division. But I have to say, what we
can
do,
all agree to disagree.
A lot of times we have a 5-0 vote because we've started from point A, and in order to get to point D, we have massaged something to the point where we could all agree on it.
Right.
And I think a lot of politics that's successful for the municipal government is the art of the compromise, mm-hmm. not the art of the deal.
Gotcha. The art of Susan Brooks. We're going to wrap it up here. We have about a minute left. Any special announcements?
Oh,
we're getting into the holidays, too.
Oh, we are. We're getting into Thanksgiving, and we want everybody, we have a lot to be grateful for, mm-hmm. so I'm very thankful, and I hope everybody does have a wonderful Thanksgiving. But prior to Thanksgiving, we do have the half marathon.
Okay.
So now it's called Lexus Lace Up, but I have been a member of Kiwanis, and back when, and this is, I believe it's the 51st year that Kiwanis has been involved. It was Kiwanis's marathon up until 4 years ago, and then it became a half marathon, and so Lexus has been running the majority of it, but Kiwanis is still very involved. But it was a Kiwanis event, and I remember blowing that whistle at the very beginning in 1993 as mayor, and I'm going to do it again this year.
And that's, is that November 17th?
November 17th, and you can get all the information. There's a 5K and a 10K, so you can get all that information online if you want to register. Mm-hmm. It's like 6 a.m.,
okay.
6:30 a.m. It's great, though.
We'll be there with our RPV TV camera.
Yeah, I'll be there.
You better have a cup of coffee. We'll have one. No.
Oh, right.
And my sneakers ready to run. Or walk. I'll be, no, who knows?
You're going to run?
I know I have an injury. I'll walk it.
Okay. You do that.
The 5K. They have a 5K part of it, I'm sure, right?
Yes, there is a 5K. I'm not doing that. I just had my knee replaced.
She's looking at me surprised. I know I'm having. Well, thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you,
really, for all you do with our PVTV and our wonderful crew here.
We've got a wonderful crew. And as we wrap it up, we're going to actually end with a piece that was our Trunk or Treat event that happens every Halloween time. And Carlos Rivera, our wonderful everything here, who's in with our production team, went and filmed that. So it was another great event put on by the city from a holiday pass, but we want to share it with the community.
That's wonderful.
All right. Thank you,
Mayor
Brooks. See you next month here in the studio.
Yes, and happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
All right. That'll do it for this edition of RPV City Talk. I'm Liz Brown Swanson with Mayor Brooks. See you next time.
My name is Mona with the City of Rancho Palos Verdes Recreation and Parks Department, and we're here at this awesome 2-for-1 event. What does that mean? We're taking our Healthy People, Healthy Pets event, and we're rolling it in with our Happy Halloween event, and all of a sudden we have a healthy Halloween. So we've got places for kids to go trick-or-treating. We have free, for example, like over here at Ralph's, we have free health screenings over here, lots of giveaways. We have some gyms here representing their what they do for a living, and it's so great because it's all about being healthy and getting out and being active in the community. We have entertainment galore. We have obstacle courses. So it's a great day.